welcome to Mosaic. My name is Rose Cora Perry, and I'm filling in today for your regular host, Sarah Darshaw. Here on Mosaic, it is our aim to celebrate the various cultures in our community and the organizations that serve them. This week on the show, we're excited to be speaking with Cara James, Public Relations and Communications Manager, and Peter Rozeluk, Executive Director for Mission Services. Welcome to the show, Cara and Peter.
Thank you.
So first off, Peter, why don't you just give our viewers an overview of exactly the mission that is behind Mission Services? What are your primary mandates?
Okay, so Mission Services is probably one of London's best-kept secrets. We've been in the city for 61 years, started off as an emergency shelter for men, and we've now expanded into five different branches, a men's emergency shelter, a family shelter, addiction rehabilitation, community mental health programs, and our mission store. So our mandate is really to provide emergency shelter, but we're more than just shelters.
And what you have for both men, women, and families.
Mm-hmm. Well, as Peter said, we are much more than just a shelter. There's so much more that we provide. Mm-hmm. Of course, it is part of our mandate to have those accommodations and those meals for the people that really need them, but there's much more. For example, the Mission Store, that is when we gratefully receive donations from the community and are able to provide these things at a lower cost to families who are struggling with poverty and with financial issues. Mm-hmm. Plus, we have our voucher program, right, which is a referral system where people can come and actually get these things for free to give them that startup. Quinton Warner, that's another example of one of the branches that we have that offers drug rehabilitation for people that are struggling. It's a four-month program, so they can come in and really get the counseling, the therapy, the help that they really need.
And can you describe for me exactly, specifically, mm-hmm, what kind of facilities you have, like what the layouts are like, where they're located?
Absolutely. Well, Rothome Women's and Family Shelter is our family shelter. It is on Stanley Street, which is just in between Warncliffe and Wortley Road. The Men's Mission and Rehabilitation Center, that is on York, just between Maitland and Colburn. Also, the Mission Store is on William, just down from Bathurst. Mm-hmm. And the community mental health programs, that is in the same location as the Men's Mission, but in the back. So they share the same space, but are two separate things.
Perfect. And Peter, I saw on your website that it looks like the Men's Mission, what your aim is, you're intending to serve men who are challenged in some way. I'm wondering, can you elaborate on that? What does that mean exactly? What kind of challenges do the clients that come to your service typically face?
So that's a very good question. I'm not sure there's any one kind of challenge or whether there's any typical type of person. I think it's a fair thing to say that many of the men that use the shelters have some sort of mental health or addiction issue. Mm-hmm. But I'm not. I'd be hesitant to say that there's a typical type of man that comes into our shelter, because there are so many different reasons for them to come in. Some is, it could be a job loss. Some are really just, you know, traveling through the city away on their way across the country. But many do have some health issues and addiction problems too.
Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, Cara, in your experience, how are the issues that the females that face that come to your services, mm-hmm, how are they unique? How are they different from those things that the men are going through?
Well, the interesting thing, Rose, is that the face of homelessness is really changing. Mm-hmm. And it's very, very different and very unique that the average person might ever imagine. So in the case of a female that would come into the Rothome Women's and Family Shelter, sometimes they come in with their partners, with their husbands,
right,
and they are struggling with homelessness and with poverty. So they're together. Sometimes they are single mothers with children. Sometimes at Rothome, it's single dads with children. So it's definitely not what we think of when we think of people struggling with homelessness. It's a very broader issue than that.
And would you say there are any unique situations or challenges specifically, mm-hmm, pertaining to the women that come to your facilities versus men?
Well, I think what's great about the services that Mission Services of London provides is that we do have a very safe place for women and families to be.
Right.
For example, the Rothome Women's and Family Shelter, the people there are families. Mm-hmm. So it isn't that they have to share a space with maybe some single men or some issues that might bring up some things that they're working through. So in that case, I think the women feel very safe and supported.
Of course.
They also are put together with a caseworker. So they have someone to help them get the resources they need, help them to get into these social service agencies, help them with everything from interview skills to some job searches to clothing, all these things together that give these women the confidence and the self-esteem that they need to move forward.
Mm-hmm. And from what I understand, surprisingly,
yes,
Ross Home is actually the only emergency family shelter in all of southwestern Ontario.
That's correct.
Despite the clear need for more facilities like this. Why do you think that remains the case?
Again, that's a great question, Rose, and one that's really difficult to answer. It's very hard to gauge when we're looking at the numbers. For example, when we're looking at the socioeconomical situation that we're in 2012,
right,
versus how many homeless people or people struggling with poverty, it's very difficult to gauge. It goes up and down. So it's hard to answer that.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that in the climate that we're in, as I said, the face of homelessness is changing.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of families, a lot of children that have parents that are married and happy that still find themselves in a situation where they need some help.
Right.
It's something that needs to be explored, because obviously the need is great. From Windsor to Hamilton, we're the only place that children that have no place to live can safely go.
For sure, and I can completely appreciate mm-hmm. that. It sounds like between the two of you, as you've explained, Mission Services is clearly doing a lot of great for our local community.
Definitely.
So when we return, we will be having a look at exactly the services that you offer in terms of mental health and rehabilitation. So stay tuned. Welcome back to Mosaic. We've been speaking with Cara James and Peter Rozeluk from Mission Services. Before the break, we overviewed the role that Mission Services plays in our community for men, women, and families who are in need. Let's now have a look at how the organization assists those with mental health issues as well as addictions. Cara, from what I understand,
yes,
mental health and homelessness are often coexisting factors.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us about some of the community mental health programs that Mission Services offers?
Absolutely. That's one of our important branches. Community mental health programs, we often refer to it as CMHP, and there are programs that coexist sometimes with the clients at Men's Mission, or people that don't live in shelter. They live under the bridge or in places that you would never imagine people living.
Right.
Streetscape, that's our crisis outreach team, frontline staff that go out into the community and work with people that won't come into a shelter.
Yeah.
Crash beds, that's our overnight crisis support bed program where they can come in overnight. There's no questions asked, there's no names taken, they just get a bed and a meal in the morning. There's a resource center that is computers and staff that can help them to get the resources they need to move out and move onward. And the gathering place, that runs from 7 a.m. to 11 a.m.
Mm-hmm.
every day, and it's a drop-in center where people, again, from the community, they come in, have a hot meal and a coffee and watch some TV and relax.
Well, it definitely sounds like you're reaching out to the community mm-hmm. in a wide variety of ways. Peter, I'm wondering if you can tell me exactly what your organization's aims are when it comes to dealing with mental health issues specifically.
I think the primary aim is really to connect them with somebody else. I mean, with government cutbacks, with reductions in mental health beds, there are people that are on the streets and in shelter and even in homes that really need to be connected with somebody else. So one of our primary jobs with the caseworkers and with Streetscape is really to connect them with other agencies, other services, other medical help.
Mm-hmm. So obviously taking advantage of all the great social services that are out there and incorporating everything that you have to offer too then.
Correct. We're trying to link them with others, and that presents a challenge sometimes, because sometimes the linkages at the other end are not there.
Mm-hmm. And I can understand that. I mean, obviously any non-for-profit kind of faces situations like that with government cutbacks, as you did say. Cara, I'm wondering, what's the process you use to identify when a new client comes in if they require mental health treatment or counseling mm-hmm. or perhaps rehab? How do you identify that, you know, because obviously it's a sensitive issue.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can tell you that for the intake process for the Men's Mission and Rehabilitation Center, for example, it is a very intensive intake process.
Mm-hmm.
So anything that would come up in evaluation or anything would definitely be dealt with. And the community mental health program is staffed by people that are able to assess these things and to get people, like Peter said, by connection to the facilities that they need. Did mm-hmm. you want to jump in on that, Peter?
No, our community mental health program actually is involved with OCAN, and
mm-hmm.
that's an acronym for an assessment piece that's done for people trying to access the mental health programs, either through hospitals or other social service agencies. So mm-hmm. that is part of our screening process, and we're tied into other agencies and the hospitals and the greater medical establishment too.
Perfect. Well, obviously that's essential because, as I said, it can be a sensitive issue.
Absolutely.
And you know, you're dealing with people who could be unpredictable at times as well, mm-hmm. particularly when it comes to addictions, which takes me to our next topic. I understand that you have a facility specifically targeted towards younger men for treating addictions. Can you tell me about the therapy that's offered at the Quinton Warner House?
Sure. So Quinton Warner House is not specifically targeted to younger men. I mean, the average age is probably in the 30s or 40s. What we have seen over the last number of years is actually a lowering of that average age, because there are younger men that are coming in, and the addictions that they're presenting are different. So Quinton Warner started about 50 years ago and was basically dealing with alcohol addictions. And what we're finding now is that the men are presenting with, you know, with drug addictions and pornography addictions and other types of addictions too. So we've actually broadened the program at Quinton Warner House, and it is a residential program.
Mm-hmm. So obviously broadening it though allows you to help even more people. So that's definitely a step in the right direction.
Correct.
Right?
Well, it is a step in the right direction. I guess the wrong direction is that there are more people that are needing these services.
So. For sure. But, you know, the more services that are out there are obviously going to benefit the greater community,
right.
For sure. So I understand there's kind of a connection between the name of the Quinton Warner House as well as the well-known addiction treatment group, Alcoholics Anonymous. Can you tell us about the history there between the two?
Can you?
Yes.
Sorry to put you on the spot there.
Yeah. Canon Quinton Warner was an Anglican canon, I guess, and he was actually instrumental in bringing Alcoholics Anonymous to Canada when Quinton Warner House was first started. So that's the connection.
Hmm.
He was instrumental in bringing Alcoholics Anonymous to Canada, but Quinton Warner House, the program there, is not a 12-step
that's
program,
right.
So it shouldn't be confused with an AA program.
Okay. It has the namesake.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, a lot of what Mission Services does would clearly not be possible without the help of our wonderful community, along with their amazing volunteers. When we come back, we'll be having a look at the Mission store as well as learning about some of their current fundraisers. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Mosaic. For those of you who are just tuning in, our guests today are Cara James and Peter Rozeluk from Mission Services. We've been discussing the various ways in which this organization assists those who struggle with poverty, homelessness, mental health issues, and addictions in our community. That's quite a large undertaking, if you ask me.
Mm-hmm.
Beyond this, you also have a store.
Yes.
And you provide clothing as well as household items to those in need. Can you tell us about your voucher program?
Yes, the voucher program is a wonderful initiative that we have at the store. We take referrals from over 40 social service agencies in London. So if somebody goes to them and needs a startup, or they need a little bit of help with clothing, household items, basic needs, maybe they're new immigrants or new refugees coming into the country and they've just arrived at the airport with nothing,
mm-hmm.
then they get a voucher and they're able to shop through the store and get the things that they need at no cost.
And that's fantastic.
It is.
And to elaborate that on, Peter, I understand that in the store you have it set up so that there's an opportunity to purchase things at inexpensive prices as well
Correct.
As on a needs basis.
Yes.
How do you determine who's eligible for the needs basis, the free items versus, you know, the nominal pricing?
Well, the free is through the voucher program.
Okay.
That's how people access the items for free.
Okay.
But if you'd like to shop there, just bring your debit card and
Are you implying
give you a special
I'm looking impoverished? Should I be offended
No,
I'm
not
totally kidding.
Not at all, because I think what we find is the Mission store really isn't it isn't really targeted to the homeless, and
right.
I see it really as being targeted at that lower strata. So when you hear Glenn Pearson talking about the different needs at the food bank and people accessing that more,
mm-hmm.
We can see that at the Mission store just through the voucher program.
Okay. Perfect. And as the winter season is starting very soon, as we know, we've gotten a little bit of a taste of it, I know that you have a Warm Hearts, Warm Hands campaign that I imagine is launched already or it's launching soon.
Yes.
Can you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, you know, I'm a mother, Rose, and I have seen those boxes come into the schools in London for years, and I never knew who it was that was behind that. So I'm so glad you give us an opportunity to say that Mission Services of London does run that program that collects those mittens, gives them to the schools so they can distribute it to their students that might not have the appropriate wear for this weather.
And have you found over the years, either one of you can answer, has this become an increased need, you know, having access to winter mitts, winter scarves, that kind of thing, or is it about the same?
So the short answer is yes.
Yes.
Yes, over the years, last year we partnered with 17 elementary schools, both in the Catholic Board and the Thames Valley Board. And the stories that you hear are just heart-wrenching. I mean, we have discovered last year when I was going through the schools and talking with the principals there that there are children in the city who are coming to school without socks.
Oh, no.
So that was one of the sort of our drives is to make sure that kids can have socks in schools. But it's boots and outer clothing and toques and mittens and things like that. So yes, unfortunately, there is a need for that.
Yes.
And how would a school go about getting involved, contacting you, saying that, you know, we definitely could implement this program at our facility, we have a need for this. How would they go about doing so?
The best thing to do is to call us at 519-433-2807, and Kim will be happy to connect them with someone that can help. But again, we've had partnerships with many, many of the schools and both of the school boards in getting these things where they need to be.
And beyond, obviously, just the Warm Hearts, Warm Hands campaign, you accept general donations for your mission store?
Oh, absolutely. The only thing that we do ask is we don't have the storage for furniture.
Okay.
So even though there are a lot of great agencies in London that could use your dresser and your bed, we wish we could, but we just don't have the room. But definitely the mission store always needs pots and pans. They always need bed linens. They always need small appliances like toasters and coffee makers. And you know what, Rose? The thing that I found the most surprising, they need can openers. Think about when you go to the food bank, what do they give you? A bunch of cans.
Right.
So if you don't have $10 to go and buy a can opener, what can you do?
And it makes perfect sense,
it
right?
Does.
I mean, you oftentimes don't put together these little
That's
things
right.
that we totally take advantage of that are everyday household appliances and items, but clearly there's a need for it, and clearly you provide a great service. And you also offer free delivery, right? And free pickup?
Yes, absolutely. Again, call the number or visit our website, missionservices.ca. And if you have something to donate, again, we can't take the furniture, unfortunately, but if you have any household items, we will come and pick it up for you.
Well, that's fantastic. With Christmas right around the corner, Mission Services also has a bunch of fundraisers on the go. Stay tuned to learn more about how you can contribute to this great organization. We'll be back. Welcome back to the final segment of this week's Mosaic. We have been chatting with Cara James, Public Relations and Communications Manager, and Peter Rozeluk, Executive Director for Mission Services. Cara, I'm wondering, can you tell me about some of these exciting fundraisers you've got going on? First, let's start about Scan Away Hunger. What is it all about?
Glad to. Scan Away is on right now to the end of December.
Okay.
This is the 18th year that we've done this, and quite simply, if you go to one of our participating partners, you can donate $3.11 at the checkout. That's some great karma coming back to you, and that money will provide one meal for one person living in shelter.
So there's a minimum donation then of?
No. If you'd like to scan more, please be our guest, but $3.11 is the national average for what it costs to provide one meal for one person in shelter. So I must mention who our partners are.
Of course.
So all of the Giant Tiger locations in London, all the Value Marts, plus Sobeys, Sunripe, and Angelo's.
That's pretty unbelievable you've got that many people on board, but also that it's only about $3 to fulfill a meal.
That's right, and when you do your grocery shopping and you're scanning through, and you get to the end of your bill, $3.11 at the bottom is nothing.
Yeah, considering how much I spend. I'm vegan and organic, so my grocery bills are a nightmare.
Man.
So that's definitely something that I think a lot of people can afford mm-hmm. and definitely be able to easily take part in.
Yeah.
So I understand your other fundraiser you got going on
yes.
is an online-based one, the online Christmas catalog.
That's
right. Can you describe that for our viewers?
Yes, if you go to our website, missionservices.ca, you'll see a little button there to click to our catalog. And basically, you shop in the comfort of your home, and you can buy items like blankets or hats or a meal, meals for children, lunches for children, shoes, socks, you name it. And you donate that money online, you pick whatever you want to buy, and we make sure that it goes to that service, that you've done that great deed.
And with that specific campaign, mm-hmm. why did you decide to make it exclusively online? What was the drive towards that decision?
That's a good question, Peter.
That's a good question.
Well, you know what? I think that in this day and age, what we want is ease.
Right.
We want people to be able to sit in their armchairs and go on their computers and know that they're doing something great.
Mm-hmm.
We don't all have time to volunteer in our busy lives.
Of course.
The ones that do, we are so grateful for, but we can't all do it.
Mm-hmm.
We can't all take all the things that we have in our junk drawers down to the mission store on a Saturday afternoon. We want to, but we can't.
Right.
So this is a way that people can sit down in their easy chairs with a cup of hot cocoa on a blustery day and get that good karma feeling.
So
it's easy.
Plus,
we're
trying to be green.
Right.
There.
If it's online or not, we already we send out enough mail as it is. So.
And speaking of green, another thing that you can do, if you have someone in your family or a loved one that's really hard to buy for,
mm-hmm.
you can buy something on their behalf, and we will give you an e-card that you can send to them saying, I have donated 12 meals to people in shelter on your behalf. So that's green and good karma.
Well, I think that definitely sounds like a good combination
yeah.
as far as I'm concerned. Is there a minimum donation to take part in that campaign?
No, absolutely not. And all the things are just like any other online shopping. It will tell you what the price is mm-hmm. and tell you what you're buying.
Well, that sounds great. I'm wondering, just to wrap things up here, if people want to learn more about these great fundraisers you've got going on,
mm-hmm.
along with Mission Services in general, where would they go for that information?
The best place is our website, missionservices.ca. Also, like us on Facebook, please. Then you'll be updated on all the great things that we're doing. We are Mission Services of London. And call us. 519-433-2807. I would love to hear from you.
Fantastic. Well, it was great having you both on the show today.
Thanks for having us.
No problem.
Thank you.
Thank you both for being guests. That's it for this episode of Mosaic. Thank you for tuning in. Again, my name is Rose Cora Perry. Thanks to Mission Services for the amazing things that they are doing in our local community. Thanks also to you for having me as your special guest host today. Tune in next time.